Hello and welcome to the episode 62 of What a Fab Day. I am your host, Simon Mas. The end of a tour, film shooting sessions, and a return home are among the things we will cover in today's episode. On the 3rd of March 1961, the Beatles, with Pete Best on drums, had their third concert at the St. John's Hall in Bootle, organized by teenager promoter Dave Forshaw. In 1962, the lads, still featuring Pete Best, performed an evening concert at the Cavern Club in Liverpool in a bill also featuring Jim McHarg's Jazzmen. Moving on to 1963, we have the final night of the Helen Shapiro package tour, with two concerts at the Gaumont Cinema in Hanley. The Beatles started the tour opening the show, last in importance between the seven acts. Then, with the success of Please Please Me in the singles chart, they moved up to become the final act of the concert's first half, working their way to stardom. It won't be long before Beatlemania would become a problem for the band. In 1964, the Beatles continued shooting their A Hard Day's Night, and specifically the train sequence. The scenes had a somewhat claustrophobic atmosphere, and the tension felt by the four musicians at their acting debut contributed to conveying the pressure characterizing their life at this stage of their career. Starting from today, and for the subsequent 4 days, the four embarked from the smaller Acton Mainline station in West London to avoid as much as possible any contact with their Beatlemaniac fans. After all, having to fight with fans like they had on the previous day in Paddington was asking for trouble, and sooner or later someone would get hurt. For the same reason, they never returned to Paddington at the end of the day, jumping off the train at suburban stations like Acton Main Line, West Stirling, Westbourne Park, and Hines and Harlington, where they were met by their drivers. Meanwhile, in Abbey Road, George Martin and his team produced the mono mixes of I Should Have Known Better, If I Fell, Tell Me Why, and I Love Her, I'm Happy Just to Dance With You, and I Call Your Name, all done between 10 a.m. and 1:45 p.m. The final result was sent to both EMI and United Artists, who owned the rights for film soundtracks of the Beatles in the United States. United Artists, in particular, didn't just need the music to prepare the album accompanying the film, but also for the Beatles to mime while shooting. As a side note, this mix of And I Love Her was not used, as another, completed on the 22nd of June, was deemed superior. Talking about superior, would you like to help me to produce even better free content? If so, please visit www.simonmas.com/support to find out what you can do. Any donation, no matter how small, will help keeping my mind off other ways to pay the bills, and I will be able to devote even more work to all sorts of music-related content. And if you don't feel like donating money, you can still circulate this episode on your social media so that I can get more awareness for this work. On the 3rd of March 1965, the Beatles kept filming Help on Cabbage Beach and Victoria Beach in the Bahamas, with the final sequence of the film with Ringo Starr being rescued from the beach seconds before being sacrificed. Sorry, big spoiler, I guess. But you didn't really wonder whether or not Ringo would survive, right? 1 year later, in 1966, manager Brian Epstein announced the dates of the Beatles' 1966 world tour, touching Germany, Japan, the Philippines, and the United States. It had not been easy to convince the Fabs to make another round of concerts. It will be impossible to talk them into doing the effort again. Different vibe in 1967, with the Beatles busy at the EMI studios in Abbey Road from 7 p.m. to 2:15 a.m. The focus of the work was Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, with James Buck, Neil Sanders, Tony Randall, and John Burden recording a four French horn part onto the song. As it had happened in other sessions, Paul McCartney sang the parts he wanted the players to play, with them and George Martin coming up with a complete score. After the recording, with John Lennon taping the chatty musicians between the various takes for his personal archive of sounds, just like he had done on the 9th of February session for Penny Lane, Paul McCartney recorded a distorted guitar solo onto the track. There's a difference of opinion about whether it was actually George performing the guitar part, but there are pictures of the day with Paul playing a Telecaster guitar, and so I think it's wise to assume that he played the part himself, also considering how particular he was with these songs. Anyhow, the session was rounded up with four more mono mixes of Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, with the fourth considered the best. Finally, on this date in 1968, Ringo Starr and his wife Maureen arrived in England after the 20-hour return flight from Delhi, India. Ringo was extra careful to make clear that he hadn't come back out of disillusionment with meditation, having nice words for the Academy and Marahishi. He proceeded to go home and send a number of 16mm film rolls to the other Beatles, who had stayed in India. And this concludes another episode of What a Fab Day. What will happen tomorrow in the life of the Beatles? There will be an infamous quote that will create lots of troubles. But you're going to see. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation.
Simon Mas, music you love.